Hi folks, and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. It's amazing where the last 3 weeks has gone, but here's a little bit about what I've been up to.
Most of my time has been spent researching for the upcoming Clay Villages exhibition that I've mentioned previously. Following discussions with other museum staff, we've decided to call this a showcase as opposed to an exhibition. The word showcase has been chosen to better describe the process of public engagement, which not only focuses on an on-site display of collection items, but also engages the community through our website and social media. In fact, keen-eyed social media users among you may have already spotted several posts related to the history of Clay Country villages in the St Austell area, including the Doctor Who post that I was working on in episode 1, when I was scanning the original negatives. The theme of Clay Villages has been ongoing since the start of November and will run till the end of January to coincide with our residence pass offer. I have therefore been digging deep into the wealth of collection items to uncover some of the stories concerning village life, and have now made a short list of collection items that will form a display in the atrium of the museum. We hope to have the display up very soon, so stay tuned to find out more. On the subject of collection items, I had said that I would elaborate on the shipping containers that featured in episode 2. Wheal Martyn will soon be undergoing an exciting program of restoration and development as part of the Clay Works project. As a result, one of our collection stores is being relocated, so some of the collection items have had to go into temporary storage, hence the shipping containers. Whilst not an ideal situation, we have specifically chosen items of a more resilient nature to go into temporary storage. For example, our collection of old tools. To mitigate environmental factors associated with this type of storage, the containers have been fitted with electrical supplies, which has permitted the use of dehumidifying units to tackle the issue of condensation. Environmental monitoring has been implemented with tiny tags, a small device that remotely monitors both humidity and temperature. I have also conducted a rudimentary study of the environment by monitoring wastewater levels in the dehumidifying units over set periods of time, as well as a visual study of metallic items to assess the risk of oxidization, rust. Alongside Joe, the curator, we will both soon be analysing the data returned from the tiny tags and employ mitigating strategies where necessary. During the last 3 weeks, I have also attended the Mid-Cornwall Museums Group meeting and also a meeting of apprentices and interns from some of the other museums across Cornwall. I had also been tasked to assist with two film nights at Wheal Martyn, and here you can see me setting up the cafe ready for the showing of Cornish Tommies and the Dawn Patrol back on the 8th of November. The cafe is a wonderfully cosy and atmospheric venue, and a great time was had by all.
Put some more coal on the fire, Smithy. It's freezing. Hi and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. This is vlog episode 4, and as you can see, we've got lots of large wheels at Wheal Martyn. This particular tyre that I'm stood in is a Bridgestone, used on the clay loaders and dumpers in the clay pits. They're 2.5 metres across, a little bit more than a metre in width, and brand new, they cost over £10,000. You can now see what I've been up to over the last few weeks while I try and figure out how to get out of this tyre. See you in a bit.
As you may remember from the previous vlog, I was busy researching the stories behind collection items in preparation for our Clay Stories Showcase exhibition, unearthing stories from our villages and towns. And just before Christmas, a group of volunteers and I installed the new exhibition, ready for the new year. For each collection item to be displayed, a ticket is filled out which indicates where the item has come from, so it is easy to return the item to the correct location at the end of the exhibition. Here you can see me retrieving a 4.5-inch howitzer shell from storage. Prior to installation, each of the shelves in the display cabinets was meticulously planned using a template to check the layout and fit of objects, and the stories were condensed into the form of captions and labels. All of the items were packed in storage boxes that corresponded with each of the shelves of the cabinets. This makes it easy to move the objects, and the boxes can be used to pack up the previous display items. To help convey the many stories that were uncovered during the research, I also edited a video which mixes old photographs and cinefilm from our AV archive, and this can be viewed on the monitor in the atrium. On the 3rd of December, I had the opportunity to discuss and promote the upcoming showcase exhibition on Radio St Austell Bay, and here you can see me visiting Nigel of the breakfast show. During the exhibition setup, I also became aware of the Cornish Object of the Year award held by the Cornwall Museums Partnership. After discussing various items with staff at Wheal Martyn, we opted to nominate our Spirit of Ecstasy figurine and mould, for which I had to write an application explaining its relevance to Cornish heritage. I was thrilled to find out on the 19th of December that we had made the shortlist. This particular object, which features in the showcase exhibition, represents the enduring relationship between Cornish clay and the aerospace industry. The mould for the hood ornament, which have adorned Rolls-Royce cars since 1911, is made from molokite, a specially blended clay product that is resistant to the extremes of heat involved in casting metal objects. Rolls-Royce not only use this for their mascot, but also in larger quantities to produce turbine blades for jet engines. Molokite has been produced in St Denis since the late 1950s, and Rolls-Royce is still a customer today. With work well underway on the restoration of our pan kiln and linney, we have continued to move display objects to temporary stores with our band of dedicated volunteers. One such group of items that needed moving was this selection of Lake's pottery, and prior to storage, each of the pots was carefully cleaned with soft brushes to remove accumulated dirt and dust. You can see the difference quite clearly when comparing these two ceramic poultry feeders side by side. With the recent spell of cold weather, another task on my to-do list was to clean and repair a dehumidifying unit which had become frozen up and inoperable. It is hard to believe I now only have 6 weeks left of my internship at Wheal Martyn, but I do hope to be in touch with a final video before I leave. For now, I shall leave you with these snowy scenes from the 31st of January.
I'm Sue Ford from Wheal Martyn Museum. We won the Host of the Year Award 2017. Here at Wheal Martyn we tell the story of the Victorian times of the clay work, so the history. We're based around two Victorian clay works. We've got the working water wheels, sandal drags, settling pits, as well as overlooking a modern day working pit, so it kind of tells the history of the industry through to present day. I'm the museum manager here at Wheal Martyn, so I take over the visitor services side of things, run the cafe, the gift shop, the admissions desk, the site team, a bit of everything really. It's very varied and I really enjoy it. Volunteers are hugely important to us here at Wheal Martyn. We couldn't do it without them. They help us from meeting and greeting to doing guided tours, helping with the curator, sorting objects. admin through to grounds work and cafe. We just couldn't run the site without them. I think volunteering opens up a whole new world for people, different places to explore, friends to meet. It's a great way to get out and about, build a bit of confidence, and I would highly recommend it to anybody.
My name's Cheryl and I volunteer for Wheal Martyn. Well, mainly for the company, but also it's such a fantastic place to work, and I do think I'm lucky. Well, my role involves mainly around the grounds, and that involves all the autumn leaves, and I also do some trimming of the rhododendrons. I'd say to someone who was thinking about volunteer, do, because you get so much out of it. I think I get more out of it than Wheal Martyn does. I mean, you've got the company, you've got the stimulus, and I do think it helps sort of in your on your CV if you want to get for future employment as well.
My name's Ian Kessel. I've been a volunteer here at Wheal Martyn for 16 years this year. I started because I grew up in this area, and I happened to come up here on a day rather like today, on an open day, and then I heard they were asking for volunteers. I thought, why not? Mostly meeting and greeting people when they come in, trying to tell them, you know, what to expect. And the thing I enjoy most is taking people around the site on the guided tours.
My name's Simon. I volunteer at Wheal Martyn because my dad had had cancer for a long time, and I wanted to come and volunteer somewhere to kind of take my mind off things, but he's passed away, and so just continued doing it, I guess, from there on. It's mostly helping Sue in the office with things like recently it was GDPR fixing that up, things for the Summer Kettle Kids Trail, making the printouts and fixing up the worksheets, and one for the water trail, and whatever else. I feel like I'm helping out, I guess. It's a nice place, nice people, everyone's friendly, everyone's helpful. I like walking around the grounds, and just happy to come in and do whatever, honestly.
We were delighted to be nominated for the Host of the Year award. I'm quite surprised, and felt fantastic to actually win it. I was sat at the table along with the two other nominees, who were amazing as well. And when our name was read out, I was just so pleased. It's great for us to be recognised for what we're doing. We have a huge bank of people that help us volunteering, and it's fantastic to be recognised for that.
Here, with a burly flutter and sting, the snow blast scampers winnowing, and dribble of foam flake seeps and bores through clay dump thickets under doors, while flurry of snow mist rises where the wagons tug till rails are bare. The smoke is battered round the stacks, soot falls with snow on trolley tracks. Even the mica channel planks and narrow walls of settling tanks are frilled and ice-splashed there between the frozen pools now sickly green. The pit edge merges with the fields, a softened gash, the claybone shields. Beyond it in the valley's fold, Virginia woods loom taut and cold.
Thank you. let there be light, and the light was good. Sun, moon, and stars out of the darkness shine,
and the light was good.
And the light was good.
Let there be light out of the darkness shine,
shine.
Let there be light, and the light was good.
Light was good.
Sun, moon, and stars out of the darkness shine,
and
the light was good.
Light was good.
And the light was good.
Let there be light out of the darkness shine. Let there be light, and the light was good.
Shine, shine, shine.
Out of the darkness.
Shine, shine, shine.
The light of the darkness.
Shine, 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 shine.
Oh, shine.
Hi folks, and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. It's amazing where the last 3 weeks has gone, but here's a little bit about what I've been up to.
Most of my time has been spent researching for the upcoming Clay Villages exhibition that I've mentioned previously. Following discussions with other museum staff, we've decided to call this a showcase as opposed to an exhibition. The word showcase has been chosen to better describe the process of public engagement, which not only focuses on an on-site display of collection items, but also engages the community through our website and social media. In fact, keen-eyed social media users among you may have already spotted several posts related to the history of Clay Country villages in the St Austell area, including the Doctor Who post that I was working on in Episode 1, when I was scanning the original negatives. The theme of Clay Villages has been ongoing since the start of November and will run till the end of January to coincide with our residence pass offer. I have therefore been digging deep into the wealth of collection items to uncover some of the stories concerning village life, and have now made a short list of collection items that will form a display in the atrium of the museum. We hope to have the display up very soon, so stay tuned to find out more. On the subject of collection items, I had said that I would elaborate on the shipping containers that featured in episode 2. Wheal Martyn will soon be undergoing an exciting programme of restoration and development as part of the Clay Works project. As a result, one of our collection stores is being relocated, so some of the collection items have had to go into temporary storage, hence the shipping containers. Whilst not an ideal situation, we have specifically chosen items of a more resilient nature to go into temporary storage, for example, our collection of old tools. To mitigate environmental factors associated with this type of storage, the containers have been fitted with electrical supplies, which has permitted the use of dehumidifying units to tackle the issue of condensation. Environmental monitoring has been implemented with tiny tags, a small device that remotely monitors both humidity and temperature. I have also conducted a rudimentary study of the environment by monitoring wastewater levels in the dehumidifying units over set periods of time, as well as a visual study of metallic items to assess the risk of oxidisation, rust. Alongside Joe, the curator, we will both soon be analysing the data returned from the tiny tags and employ mitigating strategies where necessary. During the last 3 weeks, I have also attended the Mid-Cornwall Museums Group meeting and also a meeting of apprentices and interns from some of the other museums across Cornwall. I had also been tasked to assist with two film nights at Wheal Martyn, and here you can see me setting up the cafe ready for the showing of Cornish Tommies and the Dawn Patrol back on the 8th of November. The cafe is a wonderfully cosy and atmospheric venue, and a great time was had by all.
Put some more coal on the fire, Smithy, it's freezing! Hi and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. This is vlog episode 4, and as you can see, we've got lots of large wheels at Wheal Martyn. This particular tyre that I'm stood in is a Bridgestone, used on the clay loaders and dumpers in the clay pits. They're 2.5 metres across, a little bit more than a metre in width, and brand new, they cost over £10,000. You can now see what I've been up to over the last few weeks while I try and figure out how to get out of this tyre. In a bit.
As you may remember from the previous vlog, I was busy researching the stories behind collection items in preparation for our Clay Stories Showcase exhibition, unearthing stories from our villages and towns. And just before Christmas, a group of volunteers and I installed the new exhibition, ready for the new year. For each collection item to be displayed, a ticket is filled out which indicates where the item has come from, so it is easy to return the item to the correct location at the end of the exhibition. Here you can see me retrieving a 4.5-inch howitzer shell from storage. Prior to installation, each of the shelves in the display cabinets was meticulously planned using a template to check the layout and fit of objects, and the stories were condensed into the form of captions and labels. All of the items were packed in storage boxes that corresponded with each of the shelves of the cabinets. This makes it easy to move the objects, and the boxes can be used to pack up the previous display items. To help convey the many stories that were uncovered during the research, I also edited a video which mixes old photographs and cinefilm from our AV archive, and this can be viewed on the monitor in the atrium. On the 3rd of December, I had the opportunity to discuss and promote the upcoming showcase exhibition on Radio St Austell Bay, and here you can see me visiting Nigel of the Breakfast Show. During the exhibition setup, I also became aware of the Cornish Object of the Year Award held by the Cornwall Museums Partnership. After discussing various items with staff at Wheal Martyn, we opted to nominate our Spirit of Ecstasy figurine and mould, for which I had to write an application explaining its relevance to Cornish heritage. I was thrilled to find out on the 19th of December that we had made the shortlist. This particular object, which features in the showcase exhibition, represents the enduring relationship between Cornish clay and the aerospace industry. The mould for the hood ornament, which have adorned Rolls-Royce cars since 1911, is made from molokite, a specially blended clay product that is resistant to the extremes of heat involved in casting metal objects. Rolls-Royce not only use this for their mascot, but also in larger quantities to produce turbine blades for jet engines. Molokite has been produced in St Denis since the late 1950s, and Rolls-Royce is still a customer today. With work well underway on the restoration of our pan kiln and linney, we have continued to move display objects to temporary stores with our band of dedicated volunteers. One such group of items that needed moving was this selection of Lake's pottery, and prior to storage each of the pots was carefully cleaned with soft brushes to remove accumulated dirt and dust. You can see the difference quite clearly when comparing these two ceramic poultry feeders side by side. With the recent spell of cold weather, another task on my to-do list was to clean and repair a dehumidifying unit which had become frozen up and inoperable. It is hard to believe I now only have 6 weeks left of my internship at Wheal Martyn, but I do hope to be in touch with a final video before I leave. For now, I shall leave you with these snowy scenes from the 31st of January.
I'm Sue Ford from Wheal Martyn Museum. We won the Host of the Year Award 2017. Here at Wheal Martyn we tell the story of the Victorian times of the clay work, so the history. We're based around two Victorian clay works. We've got the working water wheels, sandal drags, settling pits, as well as overlooking a modern day working pit, so it kind of tells the history of the industry through to present day. I'm the museum manager here at Wheal Martyn, so I take over the visitor services side of things, run the cafe, the gift shop, the admissions desk, site team, a bit of everything really. It's very varied and I really enjoy it. Volunteers are hugely important to us here at Wheal Martyn. We couldn't do it without them. They help us from meeting and greeting to doing guided tours, helping with the curator, sorting objects, admin, through to groundswork and cafe. We just couldn't run the site without them. I think volunteering opens up a whole new world for people, different places to explore, friends to meet. It's a great way to get out and about, build a bit of confidence, and I would highly recommend it to anybody.
My name's Cheryl and I volunteer for Wheal Martyn. Well, mainly for the company, but also it's such a fantastic place to work, and I do think I'm lucky. Well, my role involves mainly around the grounds, and that involves all the autumn leaves, and I also do some trimming of the rhododendrons. I'd say to someone who was thinking about volunteer, do, because you get so much out of it. But I think I get more out of it than Wheal Martyn does. I mean, you've got the company, you've got the stimulus, and I do think it helps sort of in your future, on your CV if you want to get for future employment as well.
My name's Ian Kessel. I've been a volunteer here at Wheal Martyn for 16 years this year. I started because I grew up in this area, and I happened to come up here on a day rather like today, on an open day, and then I heard they were asking for volunteers. I thought, why not? Mostly meeting and greeting people, and they come in trying to tell them, you know, what to expect. And the thing I enjoy most is taking people around the site on the guided tours.
My name's Simon, I volunteer at Wheal Martyn because my dad had had cancer for a long time, and I wanted to come and volunteer somewhere to kind of take my mind off things, but he's passed away, and so just continue doing it, I guess, from there on. It's mostly helping Sue in the office with things like recently it was GDPR fixing that up, things for the summer kettle kids trail, making the printouts and fixing up the worksheets, and one for the water trail and whatever else. I feel like I'm helping out, I guess. It's a nice place, nice people, everyone's friendly, everyone's helpful. I like walking around the grounds and just happy to come in and do whatever, honestly.
We were delighted to be nominated for the Host of the Year award. I'm quite surprised, and felt fantastic to actually win it. I was sat at the table along with the two other nominees, who were amazing as well. And when our name was read out, I was just so pleased. It's great for us to be recognised for what we're doing. We have a huge bank of people that help us volunteering, and it's fantastic to be recognised for that.
Here, with a burly flutter and sting, the snow blast scampers winnowing, and dribble of foam flake seeps and bores through clay dump thickets under doors, while flurry of snow mist rises where the wagons tug till rails are bare. The smoke is battered round the stacks, soot falls with snow on trolley tracks. Even the mica channel planks and narrow walls of settling tanks are frilled and ice splashed there between the frozen pools now sickly green. The pit edge merges with the fields, a softened gash, the claybone shields. Beyond it in the valley's fold, Virginia woods loom taut and cold.
Shine, shine, shine.
Shine, shine, shine.
Hi folks, and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. It's amazing where the last 3 weeks has gone, but here's a little bit about what I've been up to.
Most of my time has been spent researching for the upcoming Clay Villages exhibition that I've mentioned previously. Following discussions with other museum staff, we've decided to call this a showcase as opposed to an exhibition. The word showcase has been chosen to better describe the process of public engagement, which not only focuses on an on-site display of collection items, but also engages the community through our website and social media. In fact, keen-eyed social media users among you may have already spotted several posts related to the history of Clay Country villages in the St Austell area, including the Doctor Who post that I was working on in Episode 1, when I was scanning the original negatives. The theme of Clay Villages has been ongoing since the start of November and will run till the end of January to coincide with our residence pass offer. I have therefore been digging deep into the wealth of collection items to uncover some of the stories concerning village life, and have now made a short list of collection items that will form a display in the atrium of the museum. We hope to have the display up very soon, so stay tuned to find out more. On the subject of collection items, I had said that I would elaborate on the shipping containers that featured in Episode 2. Wheal Martyn will soon be undergoing an exciting programme of restoration and development as part of the Clay Works project. As a result, one of our collection stores is being relocated, so some of the collection items have had to go into temporary storage, hence the shipping containers. Whilst not an ideal situation, we have specifically chosen items of a more resilient nature to go into temporary storage. For example, our collection of old tools. To mitigate environmental factors associated with this type of storage, the containers have been fitted with electrical supplies, which has permitted the use of dehumidifying units to tackle the issue of condensation. Environmental monitoring has been implemented with tiny tags, a small device that remotely monitors both humidity and temperature. I have also conducted a rudimentary study of the environment by monitoring wastewater levels in the dehumidifying units over set periods of time, as well as a visual study of metallic items to assess the risk of oxidization, rust. Alongside Joe, the curator, we will both soon be analysing the data returned from the tiny tags and employ mitigating strategies where necessary. During the last 3 weeks, I have also attended the Mid-Cornwall Museums Group meeting and also a meeting of apprentices and interns from some of the other museums across Cornwall. I had also been tasked to assist with two film nights at Wheal Martyn, and here you can see me setting up the cafe ready for the showing of Cornish, Tommy's and the Dawn Patrol back on the 8th of November. The cafe is a wonderfully cosy and atmospheric venue, and a great time was had by all.
Put some more coal on the fire, Smithy. It's freezing. Hi and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. This is vlog episode 4, and as you can see, we've got lots of large wheels at Wheal Martyn. This particular tyre that I'm stood in is a Bridgestone, used on the clay loaders and dumpers in the clay pits. They're 2.5 metres across, a little bit more than a metre in width, and brand new, they cost over £10,000. You can now see what I've been up to over the last few weeks while I try and figure out how to get out of this tyre. In a bit.
As you may remember from the previous vlog, I was busy researching the stories behind collection items in preparation for our Clay Stories Showcase exhibition, unearthing stories from our villages and towns. And just before Christmas, a group of volunteers and I installed the new exhibition, ready for the new year. For each collection item to be displayed, a ticket is filled out which indicates where the item has come from, so it is easy to return the item to the correct location at the end of the exhibition. Here you can see me retrieving a 4.5-inch howitzer shell from storage. Prior to installation, each of the shelves in the display cabinets was meticulously planned using a template to check the layout and fit of objects, and the stories were condensed into the form of captions and labels. All of the items were packed in storage boxes that corresponded with each of the shelves of the cabinets. This makes it easy to move the objects, and the boxes can be used to pack up the previous display items. To help convey the many stories that were uncovered during the research, I also edited a video which mixes old photographs and cinefilm from our AV archive, and this can be viewed on the monitor in the atrium. On the 3rd of December, I had the opportunity to discuss and promote the upcoming showcase exhibition on Radio St Austell Bay, and here you can see me visiting Nigel of the Breakfast Show. During the exhibition setup, I also became aware of the Cornish Object of the Year award held by the Cornwall Museum's partnership. After discussing various items with staff at Wheal Martyn, we opted to nominate our Spirit of Ecstasy figurine and mould, for which I had to write an application explaining its relevance to Cornish heritage. I was thrilled to find out on the 19th of December that we had made the shortlist. This particular object, which features in the showcase exhibition, represents the enduring relationship between Cornish clay and the aerospace industry. The mould for the hood ornament, which have adorned Rolls-Royce cars since 1911, is made from molokite, a specially blended clay product that is resistant to the extremes of heat involved in casting metal objects. Rolls-Royce not only use this for their mascot, but also in larger quantities to produce turbine blades for jet engines. Molokite has been produced in St Denis since the late 1950s, and Rolls-Royce is still a customer today. With work well underway on the restoration of our pan kiln and linny, we have continued to move display objects to temporary stores with our band of dedicated volunteers. One such group of items that needed moving was this selection of Lake's pottery, and prior to storage, each of the pots was carefully cleaned with soft brushes to remove accumulated dirt and dust. You can see the difference quite clearly when comparing these two ceramic poultry feeders side by side. With the recent spell of cold weather, another task on my to-do list was to clean and repair a dehumidifying unit which had become frozen up and inoperable. It is hard to believe I now only have 6 weeks left of my internship at Wheal Martyn, but I do hope to be in touch with a final video before I leave. For now, I shall leave you with these snowy scenes from the 31st of January.
I'm Sue Ford from Wheal Martyn Museum. We won the Host of the Year Award 2017. Here at Wheal Martyn we tell the story of the Victorian times of the clay works, so the history. We're based around two Victorian clay works. We've got the working water wheels, sandal drags, settling pits, as well as overlooking a modern day working pit, so it kind of tells the history of the industry through to present day. I'm the museum manager here at Wheal Martyn, so I take over the visitor services side of things, run the cafe, the gift shop, the admissions desk, site team, a bit of everything really. It's very varied and I really enjoy it. Volunteers are hugely important to us here at Wheal Martyn. We couldn't do it without them. They help us from meeting and greeting to doing guided tours, helping with the curator, sorting objects, admin, through to groundswork and cafe. We just couldn't run the site without them. I think volunteering opens up a whole new world for people, different places to explore, friends to meet. It's a great way to get out and about, build a bit of confidence, and I would highly recommend it to anybody.
My name's Cheryl and I volunteer for Wheal Martyn. Well, mainly for the company, but also it's such a fantastic place to work, and I do think I'm lucky. Well, my role involves mainly around the grounds, and that involves all the autumn leaves, and I also do some trimming of the rhododendrons. I'd say to someone who was thinking about volunteer, do, because you get so much out of it. But I think I get more out of it than Wheal Martyn does. You've got the company, you've got the stimulus, and I do think it helps sort of in your future, on your CV, if you want to get for future employment as well.
My name's Ian Kessel. I've been a volunteer here at Wheal Martyn for 16 years this year. I started because I grew up in this area, and I happened to come up here on a day rather like today, on an open day, and then I heard they were asking for volunteers. I thought, why not? Mostly meeting and greeting people when they come in, trying to tell them, you know, what to expect. And the thing I enjoy most is taking people around the site on the guided tours.
My name's Simon. I volunteer at Wheal Martyn because my dad had had cancer for a long time, and I wanted to come and volunteer somewhere to kind of take my mind off things, but he's passed away, and so just continue doing it, I guess, from there on. It's mostly helping Sue in the office with things like recently it was GDPR, fixing that up, things for the Summer Kettle Kids Trail, making the printouts, and fixing up the worksheets, and one for the water trail, and whatever else. I feel like I'm helping out, I guess. It's a nice place, nice people, everyone's friendly, everyone's helpful. I like walking around the grounds, and just happy to come in and do whatever, honestly.
We were delighted to be nominated for the Host of the Year Award. I'm quite surprised, and felt fantastic to actually win it. I was sat at the table along with the two other nominees who were amazing as well. And when our name was read out, I was just so pleased. It's great for us to be recognised for what we're doing. We have a huge bank of people that help us volunteering, and it's fantastic to be recognised for that.
Here, with a burly flutter and sting, the snowblast scampers winnowing, and dribble of foam flake seeps and bores through clay dump thickets under doors, while flurry of snow mist rises where the wagons tug till rails are bare. The smoke is battered round the stacks, soot falls with snow on trolley tracks, even the mica channel planks and narrow walls of settling tanks are frilled and ice splashed there between the frozen pools now sickly green. The pit edge merges with the fields, a softened gash, the claybone shields. Beyond it in the valley's fold, Virginia woods loom taut and cold.
Shine.
Hi folks, and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. It's amazing where the last 3 weeks has gone, but here's a little bit about what I've been up to.
Most of my time has been spent researching for the upcoming Clay Villages exhibition that I've mentioned previously. Following discussions with other museum staff, we've decided to call this a showcase as opposed to an exhibition. The word showcase has been chosen to better describe the process of public engagement, which not only focuses on an on-site display of collection items, but also engages the community through our website and social media. In fact, keen-eyed social media users among you may have already spotted several posts related to the history of Clay Country villages in the St Austell area, including the Doctor Who post that I was working on in episode 1, when I was scanning the original negatives. The theme of Clay Villages has been ongoing since the start of November and will run till the end of January to coincide with our residence pass offer. I have therefore been digging deep into the wealth of collection items to uncover some of the stories concerning village life, and have now made a short list of collection items that will form a display in the atrium of the museum. We hope to have the display up very soon, so stay tuned to find out more. On the subject of collection items, I had said that I would elaborate on the shipping containers that featured in episode 2. Wheal Martyn will soon be undergoing an exciting programme of restoration and development as part of the Clay Works project. As a result, one of our collection stores is being relocated, so some of the collection items have had to go into temporary storage, hence the shipping containers. Whilst not an ideal situation, we have specifically chosen items of a more resilient nature to go into temporary storage. For example, our collection of old tools. To mitigate environmental factors associated with this type of storage, the containers have been fitted with electrical supplies, which has permitted the use of dehumidifying units to tackle the issue of condensation. Environmental monitoring has been implemented with tiny tags, a small device that remotely monitors both humidity and temperature. I have also conducted a rudimentary study of the environment by monitoring wastewater levels in the dehumidifying units over set periods of time, as well as a visual study of metallic items to assess the risk of oxidization, rust. Alongside Joe, the curator, we will both soon be analysing the data returned from the tiny tags and employ mitigating strategies where necessary. During the last 3 weeks, I have also attended the Mid-Cornwall Museums Group meeting and also a meeting of apprentices and interns from some of the other museums across Cornwall. I had also been tasked to assist with 2 film nights at Wheal Martyn, and here you can see me setting up the cafe ready for the showing of Cornish, Tommy's and the Dawn Patrol back on the 8th of November. The cafe is a wonderfully cosy and atmospheric venue, and a great time was had by all.
Put some more coal on the fire, Smithy. It's freezing. Hi and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. This is vlog episode 4, and as you can see, we've got lots of large wheels at Wheal Martyn. This particular tyre that I'm stood in is a Bridgestone, used on the clay loaders and dumpers in the clay pits. They're 2.5 metres across, a little bit more than a metre in width, and brand new, they cost over £10,000. You can now see what I've been up to over the last few weeks while I try and figure out how to get out of this tyre. In a bit.
As you may remember from the previous vlog, I was busy researching the stories behind collection items in preparation for our Clay Stories Showcase exhibition, unearthing stories from our villages and towns. And just before Christmas, a group of volunteers and I installed the new exhibition, ready for the new year. For each collection item to be displayed, a ticket is filled out which indicates where the item has come from, so it is easy to return the item to the correct location at the end of the exhibition. Here you can see me retrieving a 4.5-inch howitzer shell from storage. Prior to installation, each of the shelves in the display cabinets was meticulously planned using a template to check the layout and fit of objects, and the stories were condensed into the form of captions and labels. All of the items were packed in storage boxes that corresponded with each of the shelves of the cabinets. This makes it easy to move the objects, and the boxes can be used to pack up the previous display items. To help convey the many stories that were uncovered during the research, I also edited a video which mixes old photographs and cinefilm from our AV archive, and this can be viewed on the monitor in the atrium. On the 3rd of December, I had the opportunity to discuss and promote the upcoming showcase exhibition on Radio St Austell Bay, and here you can see me visiting Nigel of the Breakfast Show. During the exhibition setup, I also became aware of the Cornish Object of the Year award held by the Cornwall Museums Partnership. After discussing various items with staff at Wheal Martyn, we opted to nominate our Spirit of Ecstasy figurine and mould, for which I had to write an application explaining its relevance to Cornish heritage. I was thrilled to find out on the 19th of December that we had made the shortlist. This particular object, which features in the showcase exhibition, represents the enduring relationship between Cornish clay and the aerospace industry. The mould for the hood ornament, which have adorned Rolls-Royce cars since 1911, is made from molokite, a specially blended clay product that is resistant to the extremes of heat involved in casting metal objects. Rolls-Royce not only use this for their mascot, but also in larger quantities to produce turbine blades for jet engines. Molokite has been produced in St Denis since the late 1950s, and Rolls-Royce is still a customer today. With work well underway on the restoration of our pan kiln and linny, we have continued to move display objects to temporary stores with our band of dedicated volunteers. One such group of items that needed moving was this selection of Lake's pottery, and prior to storage, each of the pots was carefully cleaned with soft brushes to remove accumulated dirt and dust. You can see the difference quite clearly when comparing these two ceramic poultry feeders side by side. With the recent spell of cold weather, another task on my to-do list was to clean and repair a dehumidifying unit which had become frozen up and inoperable. It is hard to believe I now only have 6 weeks left of my internship at Wheal Martyn, but I do hope to be in touch with a final video before I leave. For now, I shall leave you with these snowy scenes from the 31st of January.
I'm Sue Ford from Wheal Martyn Museum. We won the Host of the Year Award 2017. Here at Wheal Martyn we tell the story of the Victorian times of the clay work, so the history. We're based around two Victorian clay works. We've got the working water wheels, sandal drags, settling pits, as well as overlooking a modern day working pit, so it kind of tells the history of the industry through to present day. I'm the museum manager here at Wheal Martyn, so I take care of the visitor services side of things, run the cafe, the gift shop, the admissions desk, the site team, a bit of everything really. It's very varied and I really enjoy it. Volunteers are hugely important to us here at Wheal Martyn. We couldn't do it without them. They help us from meeting and greeting to doing guided tours, helping with the curator, sorting objects, admin, through to groundswork and cafe. We just couldn't run the site without them. I think volunteering opens up a whole new world for people, different places to explore, friends to meet. It's a great way to get out and about, build a bit of confidence, and I would highly recommend it to anybody.
My name's Cheryl and I volunteer for Wheal Martyn. Well, mainly for the company, but also it's such a fantastic place to work, and I do think I'm lucky. Well, my role involves mainly around the grounds, and that involves all the autumn leaves, and I also do some trimming of the rhododendrons. I'd say to someone who was thinking about volunteer, do, because you get so much out of it. I think I get more out of it than Wheal Martyn does. I mean, you've got the company, you've got the stimulus, and I do think it helps sort of in your future, on your CV, if you want to get for future employment as well.
My name's Ian Kessel. I've been a volunteer here at Wheal Martyn for 16 years this year. I started because I grew up in this area, and I happened to come up here on a day rather like today, on an open day, and then I heard they were asking for volunteers. I thought, why not? Mostly meeting and greeting people when they come in, trying to tell them, you know, what to expect. And the thing I enjoy most is taking people around the site on the guided tours.
My name's Simon, I volunteer at Wheal Martyn because my dad had had cancer for a long time and I wanted to come and volunteer somewhere to kind of take my mind off things, but he's passed away and so just continue doing it, I guess, from there on. It's mostly helping Sue in the office with things like recently it was GDPR, fixing that up, things for the Summer Kettle Kids Trail, making the printouts and fixing up the worksheets, and one for the water trail, and whatever else I'm giving. I feel like I'm helping out, I guess. It's a nice place, nice people, everyone's friendly, everyone's helpful. I like walking around the grounds, and just happy to come in and do whatever, honestly.
We were delighted to be nominated for the Host of the Year Award. I'm quite surprised and felt fantastic to actually win it. I was sat at the table along with the two other nominees who were amazing as well. And when our name was read out, I was just so pleased. It's great for us to be recognised for what we're doing. We have a huge bank of people that help us volunteering, and it's fantastic to be recognised for that. Thank you.
Here, with a burly flutter and sting, the snow blast scampers winnowing, and dribble of foam flake seeps and bores through clay dump thickets under doors, while flurry of snow mist rises where the wagons tug till rails are bare. The smoke is battered round the stacks, soot falls with snow on trolley tracks, even the mica channel planks and narrow walls of settling tanks are frilled and ice-splashed there between the frozen pools now sickly green. The pit edge merges with the fields, a softened gash, the claybone shields. Beyond it in the valley's fold, Virginia woods loom taut and cold.
Stars out of the darkness shining,
and the light was good,
and the light was good.
Let there be light out of the darkness shining,
shine.
Let there be light, and the light was good.
Light was good.
Sun, moon, and stars out of the darkness shining,
shine.
And the light was good.
Light was good.
And the light was good.
Let there be light out of the darkness shining, let there be light, and the light was good. Thank you.
Hi folks, and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. It's amazing where the last 3 weeks has gone, but here's a little bit about what I've been up to.
Most of my time has been spent researching for the upcoming Clay Villages exhibition that I've mentioned previously. Following discussions with other museum staff, we've decided to call this a showcase as opposed to an exhibition. The word showcase has been chosen to better describe the process of public engagement, which not only focuses on an on-site display of collection items, but also engages the community through our website and social media. In fact, keen-eyed social media users among you may have already spotted several posts related to the history of Clay Country villages in the St Austell area, including the Doctor Who post that I was working on in episode 1, when I was scanning the original negatives. The theme of Clay Villages has been ongoing since the start of November and will run till the end of January to coincide with our residence pass offer. I have therefore been digging deep into the wealth of collection items to uncover some of the stories concerning village life, and have now made a short list of collection items that will form a display in the atrium of the museum. We hope to have the display up very soon, so stay tuned to find out more. On the subject of collection items, I had said that I would elaborate on the shipping containers that featured in episode 2. Wheal Martyn will soon be undergoing an exciting program of restoration and development as part of the Clay Works project. As a result, one of our collection stores is being relocated, so some of the collection items have had to go into temporary storage, hence the shipping containers. Whilst not an ideal situation, we have specifically chosen items of a more resilient nature to go into temporary storage. For example, our collection of old tools. To mitigate environmental factors associated with this type of storage, the containers have been fitted with electrical supplies, which has permitted the use of dehumidifying units to tackle the issue of condensation. Environmental monitoring has been implemented with tiny tags, a small device that remotely monitors both humidity and temperature. I have also conducted a rudimentary study of the environment by monitoring wastewater levels in the dehumidifying units over set periods of time, as well as a visual study of metallic items to assess the risk of oxidization, rust. Alongside Joe, the curator, we will both soon be analysing the data returned from the tiny tags and employ mitigating strategies where necessary. During the last 3 weeks, I have also attended the Mid-Cornwall Museums Group meeting and also a meeting of apprentices and interns from some of the other museums across Cornwall. I had also been tasked to assist with 2 film nights at Wheal Martyn, and here you can see me setting up the cafe ready for the showing of Cornish, Tommies and the Dawn Patrol back on the 8th of November. The cafe is a wonderfully cosy and atmospheric venue, and a great time was had by all.
Put some more coal on the fire, Smithy, it's freezing! Hi and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. This is vlog episode 4, and as you can see, we've got lots of large wheels at Wheal Martyn. This particular tyre that I'm stood in is a Bridgestone, used on the clay loaders and dumpers in the clay pits. They're 2.5 metres across, a little bit more than a metre in width, and brand new, they cost over £10,000. You can now see what I've been up to over the last few weeks while I try and figure out how to get out of this tyre. In a bit.
As you may remember from the previous vlog, I was busy researching the stories behind collection items in preparation for our Clay Stories Showcase exhibition, unearthing stories from our villages and towns. And just before Christmas, a group of volunteers and I installed the new exhibition, ready for the new year. For each collection item to be displayed, a ticket is filled out which indicates where the item has come from, so it is easy to return the item to the correct location at the end of the exhibition. Here you can see me retrieving a 4.5-inch howitzer shell from storage. Prior to installation, each of the shelves in the display cabinets was meticulously planned using a template to check the layout and fit of objects, and the stories were condensed into the form of captions and labels. All of the items were packed in storage boxes that corresponded with each of the shelves of the cabinets. This makes it easy to move the objects, and the boxes can be used to pack up the previous display items. To help convey the many stories that were uncovered during the research, I also edited a video which mixes old photographs and cinefilm from our AV archive, and this can be viewed on the monitor in the atrium. On the 3rd of December, I had the opportunity to discuss and promote the upcoming showcase exhibition on Radio St Austell Bay, and here you can see me visiting Nigel of the Breakfast Show. During the exhibition setup, I also became aware of the Cornish Object of the Year Award held by the Cornwall Museums Partnership. After discussing various items with staff at Wheal Martyn, we opted to nominate our Spirit of Ecstasy figurine and mould, for which I had to write an application explaining its relevance to Cornish heritage. I was thrilled to find out on the 19th of December that we had made the shortlist. This particular object, which features in the showcase exhibition, represents the enduring relationship between Cornish clay and the aerospace industry. The mould for the hood ornament, which have adorned Rolls-Royce cars since 1911, is made from molokite, a specially blended clay product that is resistant to the extremes of heat involved in casting metal objects. Rolls-Royce not only use this for their mascot, but also in larger quantities to produce turbine blades for jet engines. Molokite has been produced in St Denis since the late 1950s, and Rolls-Royce is still a customer today. With work well underway on the restoration of our pan kiln and linny, we have continued to move display objects to temporary stores with our band of dedicated volunteers. One such group of items that needed moving was this selection of Lake's pottery, and prior to storage each of the pots was carefully cleaned with soft brushes to remove accumulated dirt and dust. You can see the difference quite clearly when comparing these two ceramic poultry feeders side by side. With the recent spell of cold weather, another task on my to-do list was to clean and repair a dehumidifying unit which had become frozen up and inoperable. It is hard to believe I now only have 6 weeks left of my internship at Wheal Martyn, but I do hope to be in touch with a final video before I leave. For now, I shall leave you with these snowy scenes from the 31st of January.
I'm Sue Ford from Wheal Martyn Museum. We won the Host of the Year Award 2017. Here at Wheal Martyn we tell the story of the Victorian times of the clay work, so the history. We're based around two Victorian clay works. We've got the working water wheels, sandal drags, settling pits, as well as overlooking a modern day working pit, so it kind of tells the history of the industry through to present day. I'm the museum manager here at Wheal Martyn, so I take care of the visitor services side of things, run the cafe, the gift shop, the admissions desk, the site team, a bit of everything really. It's very varied and I really enjoy it. Volunteers are hugely important to us here at Wheal Martyn. We couldn't do it without them. They help us from meeting and greeting to doing guided tours, helping with the curator, sorting objects, admin, through to groundswork and cafe. We just couldn't run the site without them. I think volunteering opens up a whole new world for people, different places to explore, friends to meet. It's a great way to get out and about, build a bit of confidence, and I would highly recommend it to anybody.
My name's Cheryl and I volunteer for Wheal Martyn. Well, mainly for the company, but also it's such a fantastic place to work, and I do think I'm lucky. Well, my role involves mainly around the grounds, and that involves all the autumn leaves, and I also do some trimming of the rhododendrons. I'd say to someone who was thinking about volunteer, do, because you get so much out of it. I think I get more out of it than Wheal Martyn does. I mean, you've got the company, you've got the stimulus, and I do think it helps sort of in your on your CV if you want to get for future employment as well.
My name's Ian Kessel. I've been a volunteer here at Wheal Martyn for 16 years this year. I started because I grew up in this area and I happened to come up here on a day rather like today, on an open day, and then I heard they were asking for volunteers. I thought, why not? Mostly meeting and greeting people when they come in, trying to tell them, you know, what to expect. And the thing I enjoy most is taking people around the site on the guided tours.
My name's Simon. I volunteer at Wheal Martyn because my dad had had cancer for a long time and I wanted to come and volunteer somewhere to kind of take my mind off things, but he's passed away, and so just continued doing it, I guess, from there on. It's mostly helping Sue in the office with things like recently it was GDPR, fixing that up, things for the Summer Kettle Kids Trail, making the printouts and fixing up the worksheets, and one for the water trail, and whatever else I'm giving. I feel like I'm helping out, I guess. It's a nice place, nice people, everyone's friendly, everyone's helpful. I like walking around the grounds, and just happy to come in and do whatever, honestly.
We were delighted to be nominated for the Host of the Year award. I'm quite surprised, and felt fantastic to actually win it. I was sat at the table along with the two other nominees who were amazing as well. And when our name was read out, I was just so pleased. It's great for us to be recognised for what we're doing. We have a huge bank of people that help us volunteering, and it's fantastic to be recognised for that.
Here, with a burly flutter and sting, the snowblast scampers winnowing, and dribble of foam flake seeps and bores through clay dump thickets under doors, while flurry of snow mist rises where the wagons tug till rails are bare. The smoke is battered round the stacks, soot falls with snow on trolley tracks. Even the mica channel planks and narrow walls of settling tanks are frilled and ice-splashed there between the frozen pools now sickly green. The pit edge merges with the fields, a softened gash, the claybone shields. Beyond it in the valley's fold, Virginia woods loom taut and cold.
Stars out of the darkness shine,
and the light was good,
and the light was good.
Let there be light out of the darkness shine,
shine.
Let there be light, and the light was good.
Light was good.
Sun, moon, and stars out of the darkness shine,
and
the light was good.
Light was good.
And the light was good.
Let there be light out of the darkness shine. Let there be light, and the light was good.
Shine.
Hi folks, and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. It's amazing where the last 3 weeks has gone, but here's a little bit about what I've been up to.
Most of my time has been spent researching for the upcoming Clay Villages exhibition that I've mentioned previously. Following discussions with other museum staff, we've decided to call this a showcase as opposed to an exhibition. The word showcase has been chosen to better describe the process of public engagement, which not only focuses on an on-site display of collection items, but also engages the community through our website and social media. In fact, keen-eyed social media users among you may have already spotted several posts related to the history of Clay Country villages in the St Austell area, including the Doctor Who post that I was working on in episode 1, when I was scanning the original negatives. The theme of Clay Villages has been ongoing since the start of November and will run till the end of January to coincide with our residence pass offer. I have therefore been digging deep into the wealth of collection items to uncover some of the stories concerning village life, and have now made a short list of collection items that will form a display in the atrium of the museum. We hope to have the display up very soon, so stay tuned to find out more. On the subject of collection items, I had said that I would elaborate on the shipping containers that featured in episode 2. Wheal Martyn will soon be undergoing an exciting programme of restoration and development as part of the Clay Works project. As a result, one of our collection stores is being relocated, so some of the collection items have had to go into temporary storage, hence the shipping containers. Whilst not an ideal situation, we have specifically chosen items of a more resilient nature to go into temporary storage. For example, our collection of old tools. To mitigate environmental factors associated with this type of storage, the containers have been fitted with electrical supplies, which has permitted the use of dehumidifying units to tackle the issue of condensation. Environmental monitoring has been implemented with tiny tags, a small device that remotely monitors both humidity and temperature. I have also conducted a rudimentary study of the environment by monitoring wastewater levels in the dehumidifying units over set periods of time, as well as a visual study of metallic items to assess the risk of oxidisation, rust. Alongside Joe, the curator, we will both soon be analysing the data returned from the tiny tags and employ mitigating strategies where necessary. During the last 3 weeks, I have also attended the Mid-Cornwall Museums Group meeting and also a meeting of apprentices and interns from some of the other museums across Cornwall. I had also been tasked to assist with two film nights at Wheal Martyn, and here you can see me setting up the cafe ready for the showing of Cornish, Tommy's and the Dawn Patrol back on the 8th of November. The cafe is a wonderfully cosy and atmospheric venue, and a great time was had by all.
Put some more coal on the fire, Smithy. It's freezing. Hi and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. This is vlog episode 4, and as you can see, we've got lots of large wheels at Wheal Martyn. This particular tyre that I'm stood in is a Bridgestone, used on the clay loaders and dumpers in the clay pits. They're 2.5 metres across, a little bit more than a metre in width, and brand new, they cost over £10,000. You can now see what I've been up to over the last few weeks while I try and figure out how to get out of this tyre. In a bit.
As you may remember from the previous vlog, I was busy researching the stories behind collection items in preparation for our Clay Stories Showcase exhibition, unearthing stories from our villages and towns. And just before Christmas, a group of volunteers and I installed the new exhibition, ready for the new year. For each collection item to be displayed, a ticket is filled out which indicates where the item has come from, so it is easy to return the item to the correct location at the end of the exhibition. Here you can see me retrieving a 4.5-inch howitzer shell from storage. Prior to installation, each of the shelves in the display cabinets was meticulously planned using a template to check the layout and fit of objects, and the stories were condensed into the form of captions and labels. All of the items were packed in storage boxes that corresponded with each of the shelves of the cabinets. This makes it easy to move the objects, and the boxes can be used to pack up the previous display items. To help convey the many stories that were uncovered during the research, I also edited a video which mixes old photographs and cinefilm from our AV archive, and this can be viewed on the monitor in the atrium. On the 3rd of December, I had the opportunity to discuss and promote the upcoming showcase exhibition on Radio St Austell Bay, and here you can see me visiting Nigel of the Breakfast Show. During the exhibition setup, I also became aware of the Cornish Object of the Year Award held by the Cornwall Museums Partnership. After discussing various items with staff at Wheal Martyn, we opted to nominate our Spirit of Ecstasy figurine and mould, for which I had to write an application explaining its relevance to Cornish heritage. I was thrilled to find out on the 19th of December that we had made the shortlist. This particular object, which features in the showcase exhibition, represents the enduring relationship between Cornish clay and the aerospace industry. The mould for the hood ornament, which have adorned Rolls-Royce cars since 1911, is made from molokite, a specially blended clay product that is resistant to the extremes of heat involved in casting metal objects. Rolls-Royce not only use this for their mascot, but also in larger quantities to produce turbine blades for jet engines. Molokite has been produced in St Denis since the late 1950s, and Rolls-Royce is still a customer today. With work well underway on the restoration of our pan kiln and linney, we have continued to move display objects to temporary stores with our band of dedicated volunteers. One such group of items that needed moving was this selection of Lake's pottery, and prior to storage, each of the pots was carefully cleaned with soft brushes to remove accumulated dirt and dust. You can see the difference quite clearly when comparing these two ceramic poultry feeders side by side. With the recent spell of cold weather, another task on my to-do list was to clean and repair a dehumidifying unit which had become frozen up and inoperable. It is hard to believe I now only have 6 weeks left of my internship at Wheal Martyn, but I do hope to be in touch with a final video before I leave. For now, I shall leave you with these snowy scenes from the 31st of January.
I'm Sue Ford from Wheal Martyn Museum. We won the Host of the Year Award 2017. Here at Wheal Martyn we tell the story of the Victorian times of the clay work, so the history. We're based around two Victorian clay works. We've got the working water wheels, sandal drags, settling pits, as well as overlooking a modern day working pit, so it kind of tells the history of the industry through to present day. I'm the museum manager here at Wheal Martyn, so I take over the visitor services side of things, run the cafe, the gift shop, the admissions desk, the site team, a bit of everything really. It's very varied and I really enjoy it. Volunteers are hugely important to us here at Wheal Martyn. We couldn't do it without them. They help us from meeting and greeting to doing guided tours, helping with the curator, sorting objects, admin, through to groundswork and cafe. We just couldn't run the site without them. I think volunteering opens up a whole new world for people, different places to explore, friends to meet. It's a great way to get out and about, build a bit of confidence, and I would highly recommend it to anybody.
My name's Cheryl and I volunteer for Wheal Martyn. Well, mainly for the company, but also it's such a fantastic place to work, and I do think I'm lucky. Well, my role involves mainly around the grounds, and that involves all the autumn leaves, and I also do some trimming of the rhododendrons. I'd say to someone who was thinking about volunteer, do, because you get so much out of it. I think I get more out of it than Wheal Martyn does. I mean, you've got the company, you've got the stimulus, and I do think it helps sort of in your future, on your CV, if you want to get for future employment as well.
My name's Ian Kessel. I've been a volunteer here at Wheal Martyn for 16 years this year. I started because I grew up in this area and I happened to come up here on a day rather like today, on an open day, and then I heard they were asking for volunteers. I thought, why not? Mostly meeting and greeting people when they come in, trying to tell them, you know, what to expect. And the thing I enjoy most is taking people around the site on the guided tours.
My name's Simon and I volunteer at Wheal Martyn because my dad had had cancer for a long time and I wanted to come and volunteer somewhere to kind of take my mind off things, but he's passed away and so just continued doing it, I guess, from there on. It's mostly helping Sue in the office with things like recently it was GDPR fixing that up, things for the Summer Kettle Kids Trail, making the printouts and fixing up the worksheets, and one for the water trail, and whatever else. I feel like I'm helping out, I guess. It's a nice place, nice people, everyone's friendly, everyone's helpful. I like walking around the grounds and just happy to come in and do whatever, honestly.
We were delighted to be nominated for the Host of the Year Award. I'm quite surprised and felt fantastic to actually win it. I was sat at the table along with the two other nominees who were amazing as well. And when our name was read out, I was just so pleased. It's great for us to be recognised for what we're doing. We have a huge bank of people that help us volunteering, and it's fantastic to be recognised for that.
Here, with a burly flutter and sting, the snow blast scampers winnowing, and dribble of foam flake seeps and bores through clay dump thickets under doors, while flurry of snow mist rises where the wagons tug till rails are bare. The smoke is battered round the stacks, soot falls with snow on trolley tracks, even the mica channel planks and narrow walls of settling tanks are frilled and ice splashed there between the frozen pools now sickly green. The pit edge merges with the fields, a softened gash, the claybone shields. Beyond it in the valley's fold, Virginia woods loom taut and cold.
Stars out of the darkness shining,
and the light was good.
And the light was good.
Let there be light out of the darkness shining,
shine.
Let there be light, and the light was good.
Light was good.
Sun, moon, and stars out of the darkness shining,
shine.
And the light was good.
Light was good.
And the light was good.
Let there be light out of the darkness shining, let there be light, and the light was good. Thank you.
Hi folks, and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. It's amazing where the last 3 weeks has gone, but here's a little bit about what I've been up to.
Most of my time has been spent researching for the upcoming Clay Villages exhibition that I've mentioned previously. Following discussions with other museum staff, we've decided to call this a showcase as opposed to an exhibition. The word showcase has been chosen to better describe the process of public engagement, which not only focuses on an on-site display of collection items, but also engages the community through our website and social media. In fact, keen-eyed social media users among you may have already spotted several posts related to the history of Clay Country villages in the St Austell area, including the Doctor Who post that I was working on in episode 1, when I was scanning the original negatives. The theme of Clay Villages has been ongoing since the start of November and will run till the end of January to coincide with our residence pass offer. I have therefore been digging deep into the wealth of collection items to uncover some of the stories concerning village life, and have now made a short list of collection items that will form a display in the atrium of the museum. We hope to have the display up very soon, so stay tuned to find out more. On the subject of collection items, I had said that I would elaborate on the shipping containers that featured in episode 2. Wheal Martyn will soon be undergoing an exciting programme of restoration and development as part of the Clay Works project. As a result, one of our collection stores is being relocated, so some of the collection items have had to go into temporary storage, hence the shipping containers. Whilst not an ideal situation, we have specifically chosen items of a more resilient nature to go into temporary storage, for example, our collection of old tools. To mitigate environmental factors associated with this type of storage, the containers have been fitted with electrical supplies, which has permitted the use of dehumidifying units to tackle the issue of condensation. Environmental monitoring has been implemented with tiny tags, a small device that remotely monitors both humidity and temperature. I have also conducted a rudimentary study of the environment by monitoring wastewater levels in the dehumidifying units over set periods of time, as well as a visual study of metallic items to assess the risk of oxidization, rust. Alongside Joe, the curator, we will both soon be analysing the data returned from the tiny tags and employ mitigating strategies where necessary. During the last 3 weeks, I have also attended the Mid-Cornwall Museums Group meeting and also a meeting of apprentices and interns from some of the other museums across Cornwall. I had also been tasked to assist with two film nights at Wheal Martyn, and here you can see me setting up the cafe ready for the showing of Cornish, Tommy's and the Dawn Patrol back on the 8th of November. The cafe is a wonderfully cosy and atmospheric venue, and a great time was had by all.
Put some more coal on the fire, Smithy. It's freezing. Hi and welcome back to Wheal Martyn. This is vlog episode 4, and as you can see, we've got lots of large wheels at Wheal Martyn. This particular tyre that I'm stood in is a Bridgestone, used on the clay loaders and dumpers in the clay pits. They're 2.5 metres across, a little bit more than a metre in width, and brand new, they cost over £10,000. You can now see what I've been up to over the last few weeks while I try and figure out how to get out of this tyre. In a bit.
As you may remember from the previous vlog, I was busy researching the stories behind collection items in preparation for our Clay Stories Showcase exhibition, unearthing stories from our villages and towns. And just before Christmas, a group of volunteers and I installed the new exhibition, ready for the new year. For each collection item to be displayed, a ticket is filled out which indicates where the item has come from, so it is easy to return the item to the correct location at the end of the exhibition. Here you can see me retrieving a 4.5-inch howitzer shell from storage. Prior to installation, each of the shelves in the display cabinets was meticulously planned using a template to check the layout and fit of objects, and the stories were condensed into the form of captions and labels. All of the items were packed in storage boxes that corresponded with each of the shelves of the cabinets. This makes it easy to move the objects, and the boxes can be used to pack up the previous display items. To help convey the many stories that were uncovered during the research, I also edited a video which mixes old photographs and cinefilm from our AV archive, and this can be viewed on the monitor in the atrium. On the 3rd of December, I had the opportunity to discuss and promote the upcoming showcase exhibition on Radio St Austell Bay, and here you can see me visiting Nigel of the Breakfast Show. During the exhibition setup, I also became aware of the Cornish Object of the Year Award held by the Cornwall Museums Partnership. After discussing various items with staff at Wheal Martyn, we opted to nominate our Spirit of Ecstasy figurine and mould, for which I had to write an application explaining its relevance to Cornish heritage. I was thrilled to find out on the 19th of December that we had made the shortlist. This particular object, which features in the showcase exhibition, represents the enduring relationship between Cornish clay and the aerospace industry. The mould for the hood ornament, which have adorned Rolls-Royce cars since 1911, is made from molokite, a specially blended clay product that is resistant to the extremes of heat involved in casting metal objects. Rolls-Royce not only use this for their mascot, but also in larger quantities to produce turbine blades for jet engines. Molokite has been produced in St Denis since the late 1950s, and Rolls-Royce is still a customer today. With work well underway on the restoration of our pan kiln and linney, we have continued to move display objects to temporary stores with our band of dedicated volunteers. One such group of items that needed moving was this selection of Lake's pottery, and prior to storage, each of the pots was carefully cleaned with soft brushes to remove accumulated dirt and dust. You can see the difference quite clearly when comparing these two ceramic poultry feeders side by side. With the recent spell of cold weather, another task on my to-do list was to clean and repair a dehumidifying unit which had become frozen up and inoperable. It is hard to believe I now only have 6 weeks left of my internship at Wheal Martyn, but I do hope to be in touch with a final video before I leave. For now, I shall leave you with these snowy scenes from the 31st of January.
I'm Sue Ford from Wheal Martyn Museum. We won the Host of the Year Award 2017. Here at Wheal Martyn we tell the story of the Victorian times of the clay work, so the history. We're based around two Victorian clay works. We've got the working water wheels, sandal drags, settling pits, as well as overlooking a modern day working pit, so it kind of tells the history of the industry through to present day. I'm the museum manager here at Wheal Martyn, so I take over the visitor services side of things, run the cafe, the gift shop, the admissions desk, site team, a bit of everything really. It's very varied and I really enjoy it. Volunteers are hugely important to us here at Wheal Martyn. We couldn't do it without them. They help us from meeting and greeting to doing guided tours, helping with the curator, sorting objects, admin, through to grounds work and cafe. We just couldn't run the site without them. I think volunteering opens up a whole new world for people, different places to explore, friends to meet. It's a great way to get out and about, build a bit of confidence, and I would highly recommend it to anybody.
My name's Cheryl and I volunteer for Wheal Martyn. Well, mainly for the company, but also it's such a fantastic place to work, and I do think I'm lucky. Well, my role involves mainly around the grounds, and that involves all the autumn leaves, and I also do some trimming of the rhododendrons. I'd say to someone who was thinking about volunteer, do, because you get so much out of it. I think I get more out of it than Wheal Martyn does. I mean, you've got the company, you've got the stimulus, and I do think it helps sort of in your future, on your CV, if you want to get for future employment as well.
My name's Ian Kessel. I've been a volunteer here at Wheal Martyn for 16 years this year. I started because I grew up in this area, and I happened to come up here on a day rather like today, on an open day, and then I heard they were asking for volunteers. I thought, why not? Mostly meeting and greeting people when they come in, trying to tell them, you know, what to expect. And the thing I enjoy most is taking people around the site on the guided tours.
My name's Simon and I volunteer at Wheal Martyn because my dad had had cancer for a long time and I wanted to come and volunteer somewhere to kind of take my mind off things, but he's passed away and so just continued doing it, I guess, from there on. It's mostly helping Sue in the office with things like recently it was GDPR fixing that up, things for the summer kettle kids trail, making the printouts and fixing up the worksheets, and one for the water trail and whatever else. And I feel like I'm helping out, I guess. It's a nice place, nice people, everyone's friendly, everyone's helpful. I like walking around the grounds and just happy to come in and do whatever, honestly.
We were delighted to be nominated for the Host of the Year Award. I'm quite surprised and felt fantastic to actually win it. I was sat at the table along with the two other nominees who were amazing as well. And when our name was read out, I was just so pleased. It's great for us to be recognised for what we're doing. We have a huge bank of people that help us volunteering, and it's fantastic to be recognised for that.
Here, with a burly flutter and sting, the snow blast scampers winnowing, and dribble of foam flake seeps and bores through clay dump thickets under doors, while flurry of snow mist rises where the wagons tug till rails are bare. The smoke is battered round the stacks, soot falls with snow on trolley tracks, even the mica channel planks and narrow walls of settling tanks are frilled and ice splashed there between the frozen pools now sickly green. The pit edge merges with the fields, a softened gash, the claybone shields. Beyond it in the valley's fold, Virginia woods loom taut and cold.
Thank you.